Well, hi, everybody. I'm Dominic Tarpey. I'm a member of the committee that puts together this particular series of grand rounds here at the UCSF Department of Psychiatry and Behavioral Sciences. I am going to turn the floor over to Josiah Stickles to introduce our great speakers today. Josiah Stickles is the Clinical Administrative Director here for Intensive Services at Langley, Porter, and in the department. So we'll probably have a few people trickling in as we get started, but I'll go ahead and turn it over to Josiah. Josiah?
On mute.
There we go. I was waiting for permission. Permission granted.
Permission has been granted.
Good afternoon, everybody. I'm happy to introduce Melissa and Cynthia as today's Intensive Services Grand Round speakers. An easy introduction to give, as I have worked with both of them throughout their time with Langley Porter. They also have a lot in common, as you'll hear. Melissa has been here 1 month longer than I have, for going on 12 years, and Cynthia is going on 7. Melissa and Cynthia are both licensed marriage and family therapists, work as primary clinicians in the partial hospitalization and intensive outpatient programs here at Langley Porter, and specialize in expressive arts therapy, which they're going to discuss. EXA, as expressive arts is often referred to, is a creative arts therapy. Both Cynthia and Melissa are graduates of the California Institute of Integral Studies with master's degrees in counseling psychology, concentrations in expressive arts therapy. Melissa also attended Cal Berkeley for her BA in psychology and graduated with high honors. She spent a summer in Switzerland for an intensive on EXA. She's bilingual in Spanish. Her clinical work has included work with developmental disabilities, with Alzheimer's patients, and with parents. Prior to the pandemic, Melissa enjoyed spending time with her family and recently has taken up raising chickens. Cynthia, prior to her CIS, attended San Francisco State for her BA in urban studies. Populations she has worked with include families, domestic violence survivors, and Alzheimer's patients. Cynthia is also bilingual in Spanish and has done counseling services in Spanish in prior positions. Cynthia has the most interesting stories of different jobs she has held in the past, including, I think, a fishery in Alaska. She spent 6 months in Guatemala in the late 90s and played percussion with musical ensembles in California and Spain. The two are working together on co-authoring a book on the US, on the use of EXA in acute psychiatry. And without further ado, I will hand it off to Melissa and Cynthia.
Thanks, Josiah.
Thanks, Josiah. Nice to see so many familiar faces. So I want to say a little bit about my background in the arts. Josiah has shared a lot. I've been doing dance most of my life, starting as a youngster with tap dance, modern dance. Most recently, for the last about 10 years off and on, I've been with the San Francisco Tsunami swim team on the synchronized swim team. Very fun. And then with visual arts, I've always focused on this for calming, honoring things, insight, drawing and doodling. Most recently, I've been doing a lot of hippie tie-dye and then like going to beautiful places and making arrangements based on natural materials I find. Some theater as well. Let's see, I guess Josiah already kind of went over the educational stuff, so I'm going to pass to Cynthia.
Yeah, thank you. So my background in the arts, as Josiah mentioned, is primarily through percussion. I love Middle Eastern percussion, and I've played with a few different ensembles, played Andalusian music in Spain with a Moroccan group, and then have played Turkish and Arabic classical and folk tunes with some ensembles here in San Francisco. I've also done a little bit of dabbling in poetry and photography, and this last year have been doing, I've been playing guitar, actually learning chords and singing, which has been really new and different and fun. I think we're going to get started with the slideshow. I think we're ready for that. So I'm going to share my screen, and we're going to go in here. Okay.
So while Cynthia's figuring that out, I'm going to tell you a little bit about what we're going to do today. Yeah. So we're going to start with some definitions in expressive arts therapy, go through some of the core concepts, some things that we keep in mind in using expressive arts therapy, and then also talking through some practical uses of the arts. There will be a lot on this PowerPoint, too many words than you could possibly read, but you can look at it later and we'll tell you the essentials there. And then in the second half of the group, we'll be going into an experiential. So I'm going to ask you to, in the next half hour or so, grab two pieces of something to draw on, pieces of paper. It doesn't have to be fancy. It could be the back of a receipt or something like that. And then something to draw with. We'll end with questions.
Okay. So expressive arts therapy, what is it? How does it work? So we know that the use of arts for health and well-being is part of humankind's collective history as a response to trauma, to loss. The arts are well documented across cultures, and we can see this through the many different genres of music that exist, dance forms, painting, sculpture, textiles, oral traditions, in rituals that mark the rites of passage that we have, seasons, birth, and death. And the arts are forms of self-expression that not only complement therapy, but also augment the possibilities for change and for insight and for growth.
And then to give a couple of clarifications, so Josiah mentioned this word creative arts therapies, this phrase. Creative arts therapies encompasses a variety of different approaches to therapy and using the arts for healing. So you've probably heard about music therapy, drama therapy, art therapy, dance therapy. These are all different organizations. They have training programs, certifications, conferences. Expressive arts therapies is one of the creative arts therapies. And our emphasis is the relationship between the arts. And we adapt to the different modalities of arts to the needs of the patient. It's very accessible, focus on accessibility.
So we're gonna go over some core principles now, and low skill, high sensitivity being one of them. So a person doesn't have to have an arts background to benefit from this process. And actually sometimes having an arts background is like a hurdle that you have to get over because you may have some skills or you may have some expectation of skill, expectation of aesthetics. And with clear and simple directives, the pressure of trying to impress is removed, it's hopefully removed. And so patients are guided into their senses so that the focus is on their experience of the materials and their own process. And I might say things like, can you find a couple different sounds on this instrument? Let your eyes choose a color. Or maybe I might say, notice the speed and the pressure of your brush strokes as you paint.
Then going into process over product. So the emphasis is on in the moment discovery rather than rendering something accurately or imitating something that you see or that you're responding to. So I might say something I often say as an introduction in group. This is not art class. We're not trying to make something beautiful. We're trying to gain a perspective on something that we've learning about yourself. And the process focus is really exciting. It can be come up with some really unique and personal kind of actually products. So an example here would be if we're focusing on the self-critic, then I might direct people to sense into the part of themselves that is the self-critic, maybe kind of the urge, the physical sensations of that, a movement, and allow that shape, that movement to emerge on the page rather than I'm going to look in the mirror and draw a picture of myself with a scowl, and I'm focusing on, you know, self-criticism and getting it right. So process over product, and then going into creativity with constraints. Our creative minds actually like limitations, benefit from limitations. So we start simply, we start with some sort of format to what we're doing, and then we build upon it. And sometimes, you know, artists like to rebel, we rebel against limitations. So an example here might be to really explore the touch paint points of your feet on the floor, helpful for grounding, or the qualities of expansion and contraction through your body, not do a little dance. You're more likely then to go into stereotypical movements, less personal. So art making can feel intimidating sometimes, risky. This can help it feel safer, a starting point.
Okay, so we're gonna talk a little bit about the intermodal approach and crystallization. So this is about using a combination of arts interventions, and this helps broaden a patient's play space. And the play space is, you know, essentially their ability to be in the moment, to engage with their senses, to engage with the materials, to be spontaneous, to explore, to take safe risks. And the intermodal approach really supports DBT or any therapeutic model, really, because what it's doing is trying to increase psychological flexibility. And we know that with increased psychological flexibility, we get a decrease in depression and a decrease in anxiety. I'm just going to give an example of how these two things can work together. And this was a patient that came into our PHP IOP, was in her late 40s, and she came in the context of worsening depression, increased anxiety. She was in the middle of a divorce, and she had a history of a very abusive mother. And we did an arts process that started with drawing, and then we moved into finding a gesture for the drawing, and then we moved into some open form poetry. And nearing the end of this intermodal approach, she had this aha moment. And the aha moment was this, essentially. She had been unprotected from her mother. And the part of her work in getting better and moving forward was to establish boundaries with her mother. And that was a really lovely experience to be able to witness that in group and for her to benefit from the process. So she had a crystallization through an intermodal process. Okay.
Big list of lots of words. You'll get this later. So we're going to go over to some different forms of arts and also just general guidelines here with these different forms of arts. This is how Cynthia and I think about this stuff. We plan our interventions based on the PHP and IOP population that we're working with. So there's creativity with constraints right there. And characteristics of our population is that there's severe depression, oftentimes severe anxiety, psychosis. There's rolling admissions. It's not a closed group, but people coming in and out. It's relatively brief therapy. So we want to keep it simple. We need to warm them up often. They're less likely to want to take immediate risks and just plunge themselves in there to creative processes. And also we want to be sensitive to potential triggers. So movement. I love movement for assessment. It's my favorite form of art for assessment. I think you can tell quite a lot about how the person feels in their relationship to the group and with the use of space, how much space they're taking up, body rigidity, self-consciousness. You can pick up that on pretty quickly. Also how well they're tracking these interventions. It's really good. Movement is for relaxation, for building energy again, if the energy is stagnant. So they're tracking again, camaraderie. I would not use this in person if there's a patient with especially poor boundaries or a sense of threat. And then also if there are physical limitations, then you want to be fairly open to, you know, maybe they need to stay seated or qualities of movement, like I mentioned before, rather than doing exactly this movement that I'm suggesting. Moving into drama. Drama can potentially be, Josiah will like this, the most fun, the most funny, connected. There's in the moment practice. I'm working on these skills, interpersonal skills right here, my relationship skills, maybe enacting a ritual. It can also feel really risky. So you need to make sure to warm up activities I'll talk about later. And then also if you're putting on a role, then to step out of that role, come back to regular life. It's difficult, therefore, if there's a poor self-concept, poor ego strength. It's not great for people with poor boundaries or aggression either. And then visual art. Visual art can be really calming, containing. It's really good for practicing mindfulness, insight building. I can look at what I've drawn later. Maybe it makes different sense to me later. It's private. It's kind of a one-on-one experience rather than a group experience. most of the time. And so it's not the best for group cohesion if that's the main purpose.
Mm-hmm. And with language, you know, we have access to metaphors, and a metaphor can instantly create a whole picture, and a metaphor can really help us perceive subtle connections, right? So there's a lot of that language can do to help us reflect. We can also rewrite old stories. We can change a narrative that's no longer serving. So, you know, writing is, language is generally a contained experience. It's low risk, depending on how much is chosen to share, you know, we choose to share. And then sounds, my favorite. It's great for changing mood. It's great for group connection. It can easily assist visual art. It's a wonderful way for people to connect to their listening, to actually create group cohesion. And on the flip side, sound can be overstimulating for some patients. It can also be uncontained if it's not facilitated, you know, enough. And we also need to consider lyrics can be triggering. Familiar songs may be triggering. So I generally, if I'm going to actually play a selection of music, I would choose something that doesn't have words and is probably not that popular, so that people won't be triggered and won't think back to other times. So that's something to consider when using sound. We're going to switch gears just a little bit right here, and we're going to get into some dialectical behavior modules and arts interventions that complement them. We're going to start here with mindfulness. So generally with mindfulness, you know, we're going to be working with slower, more introspective activities, including some movement or stretches, maybe visual arts, maybe some listening to sound or music, maybe even making a little bit of music. And while we're doing these processes, we're going to be making lots of reminders to the patients to come back to the present moment. We're trying to help them not attach to thoughts, to recognize and allow feelings and sensations through the process. And what we're trying to do is help them grow the space between stimulus and response so that they're able to decrease their emotional reactivity. And a lot of the interventions that are on this sheet are highlighting wise mind, which is a concept in DBT, like your inner wisdom. But I want to talk a little bit about non-judgment, which is a core aspect of mindfulness. And if you can't go straight to non-judgment, then noticing judgments. But the opposite of judgment is curiosity and kindness. And if that's too far a stretch, then stating facts is a good starting point. And I think we have found with a lot of the patients that we see that curiosity and kindness toward oneself is too far a stretch. So actually stating a fact is like the next step on in the direction toward curiosity and kindness. So after any kind of simple visual arts practice, I would ask the patients to share two truths and a judgment. That's like a little bit of a game, right? So two truths and a judgment about their work. And then they share it with the group. And we discuss as a group the difference between those statements and help each other, because sometimes actually people are making judgments that they think are truths. And so it's a really, it's a nice way to work with mindfulness and judgment. Emotion regulation. Okay, so when we're working on these skills, we're really going to be using any art form that focuses on the expression of emotions. And so hopefully the arts can be a safety net to deepen their experience of their emotions here. This is about decreasing the intensity and decreasing the frequency of unwanted emotions. It's about inviting positive emotions into your life. One skill that I'll talk about here is opposite action. And it's a well-known skill, you know, there's an emotion, it's not suiting you, you're finding that it's actually not quite justified. How do you change this emotion? You do it through an opposite action. I like to do opposite action music playlists. And so I will lead a group, we'll brainstorm emotions that that they want to regulate, like lethargy, despair, overwhelm, anger, shame, these sorts of feelings. And then we're gonna next brainstorm emotions that they want to feel that are like the opposite of these feelings. So motivation, peace, release, validation, gratitude, these kinds of feelings. And then this actually works really well on Zoom, but I'll have them send me a song. And if they don't have a song, I'll just say, you can give me a genre or an artist, and they will write it in the chat, and I will quickly put together a playlist on Spotify. And then everyone has some simple materials, and we'll listen to about 3 minutes of each song. And as we're listening to each patient's selection, we have like a little square on our sheet where we're kind of doing some mindful drawing. We're listening to the music, we're noticing how it feels when we're drawing. And then after about 3 minutes of that, I'll ask the patient, you know, how does that song make you feel and why did you choose it? And then, you know, they might plan how to use this going forward.
Right, moving into the next module of distress tolerance. So here we're really focusing on managing emotional crisis without engaging in behaviors that are going to make the situation worse. ARTS activities here involve visualization, enacting future scenarios, kind of taking a look at the long-term effects of a destructive behavior or not, radical acceptance kind of things. I'll talk about that more in the moment. Also practicing in the moment ARTS activities. What can I do right now to distract, to soothe myself? So I'll talk about one in particular. So with radical acceptance is if you're not familiar with it, it's essentially the serenity prayer from 12 step. So grant me the serenity to accept what I cannot change, courage to change what I can, the wisdom to know the difference. So I'll have patients identify a stressful situation, something they need to accept, and find an object or an image that represents it. If we're in person, then I use my own cards, but maybe they can find something at home. And then I like to use a Tarot Brock visualization meditation. It's called the big squeeze. So they're sensing, they're visualizing this part of themselves that reacts in a habitual way, in a non-accepting sort of way. What is that like to feel into that experience? And then also feeling into the experience of the wise response, the part of you that is mindfully attending to the situation and actually toward acceptance. And then from this part, the wise adapted part of yourself, then you're finding another image or object that represents that well enough and writing a message from that part of that image to yourself. And then moving into interpersonal effectiveness. So these skills are our relationship skills. Balancing needs and wants with overall goals in the relationship. Maybe it's more about connection, more about boundaries, maintaining and improving self-respect within relationships as well. A lot of drama and role play is appropriate here, writing for practicing assertive communication skills. We might also, for in the moment kind of connecting things, play games, music making, group art making where we're participating with one another, drawing to visualize relationships, the state of relationships, relationship patterns. So an example is Dear Woman, AKA Dear Man. This is an acronym. This is essentially an assertiveness script where I'm identifying wants and needs and how can I express this in an effective way. So, and the dear part is describe, express, assert, reinforce. So it might practice with some writing, identifying or rehearsal, what I want, what I need, a rapid rehearsal in the group. And then as a warm up, then we'll do a sculpt, something with your body where you're showing with posture, with facial expression, what aggressiveness looks like, what passive aggressiveness looks like, what an assertive response would look like. Warming up with a role circle. So a role circle is like 1 minute, we're gonna in pairs act out this scene where one person's a dragon, the other's a knight, it's very physical, shy five-year-olds, noisy neighbor and expressing yourself around them. And then choosing a scenario from a list, or maybe somebody has an example that comes to mind and you know, I got a bad haircut and I'm gonna talk to the stylist about it. I like to do a do-over where we start with responding to this person in an unregulated sort of way, maybe an aggressive way, and then do it again with your assertiveness skill with Dear Woman. So a lot here for Zoom adaptations. In the Zoom land, we've had to make some adaptations. There are pros and cons. I'm not going to say all of this, but generally a pro is that people are in their own homes and they can access materials long-term at home. It can also be inclusive of withdrawn patients. Con would be that it reduces some of the natural bonding like chit-chat.
Okay, So we're going to get to harvesting questions. So what do we do with this work once it's been done, right? This is where we make meaning from the experience. So we might ask a patient to introduce the art. We encourage open-ended discussion that invites disclosure but never demands it. Sometimes it's enough for a person to just make the work and let the work speak for itself. And they may not want to say anything else about it. If that's the case, you know, you could say, like, how was your experience of making it, if they're willing to do that much. We really try not to name work for them. For example, like if I said, you know, what a cute cat to a patient who had just drawn a leopard, that would be really disappointing, right, to the patient to hear something like that. We also want to refrain from saying things like, what is it? We would refrain from saying, this is beautiful. I like it, right? Those statements are not helpful. Why? Because we're there as an observer and our curiosity is, you know, hopefully going to help them learn something about themselves. So, you know, you could ask a patient, you know, because sometimes they really want your feedback. You know, you might say, would you like my impression? And if they say yes, then you could say something that would be owning your own response and never interpreting and never analyzing their work. So, you know, I might say something like, when I look at this drawing, I feel sad. I might say something like, this image makes me think about connection. Okay, so it's really not about interpreting, it's about harvesting from their own experience. And then there's a whole list of different kinds of harvesting questions you might ask after a multimodal experience.
Okay, so let's go into the sequence. This is how it might shape out in the context of a group. We're warming up with simple, brief, structured activities, actually just warming up the actual muscles that we'll be using in the main intervention in order to enter the play space as well. So play space, not meaning silliness, but meaning entering into the space of creative flexibility. So warm-ups might be something like a question to personalize the skill, maybe a paired activity, some sort of directive movement activity or a sensory attention sort of thing. One thing that I've been enjoying on Zoom, it's called Where in the World. And so if I look at Cynthia and everybody points at Cynthia at the same time, like use your finger to point at Cynthia, it's going to look different on everybody's screen, right? So it's kind of fun. It's a warm-up because patients are now using their eyes and they're looking at each other, and then we can move on to something else that's the main intervention. So the main intervention, this is the meat of it. As we've discussed before, we've mentioned a bunch of these. Maybe it will be 5 to 15 minutes. When I'm teaching a DBT skill like opposite action, then I like to pepper in some interventions here and there. The final PHP group of the day is a more extended deepening practice where maybe it's something with a full kind of full experience sort of thing. So we've talked to some of those. Cynthia talked about harvesting questions. I like to plan ahead of time. What are the sorts of things that I'm interested in hearing them speak to? You should allow a good amount of time for insights, though. Maybe some quiet, some silence after the creative intervention, because they need to some time to come back to their words. And then finally, because we are a stabilization program or a change-based program, then applying, what's the application to your life? How are you going to bring this into your life? What do you feel motivated to do? So we might have homework suggestions, such as an act of kindness or an assertion or a mindful walk. Okay. Now we're going to go into our practice. I hope that everybody had a chance to grab two receipts, you know, nothing fancy necessarily, two pieces of paper and something to draw with. So I'd like you to take a moment to identify in your mind some sort of situation, a topic that you'd like to hold lightly in your mind through this. Could be something personal, maybe something professional, maybe you're focusing on a particular patient, and you'll just kind of hold this in your mind a little bit as you draw. I'm going to give you about, let's see, how much time are we going to give them, Cynthia? 3 minutes? How many minutes?
Three minutes.
Three? Okay, three. 3 minutes is good. Just about 3 minutes where you're drawing. If you don't know where to start, then just close your eyes and do a bit of a scribble, and then you can open your eyes and add details. And they'll give you about 3 minutes to do that initial drawing on that first piece of paper. Bring this drawing to a pause wherever you are with it. Take a moment to look over what you've drawn and find a part of it that's especially charged, some part of this drawing that you've made that kind of has some extra energy to it, interest to it. And then on the second piece of paper, you're going to expand this. So start with this part of the previous drawing, and you'll likely change it a little bit, embellish it a little bit as you go into the second drawing, but using the second piece of paper, and I'll give you another 3 minutes. Thank you. bring it to a pause. Good moment in the movement or music. Okay, take a look at this second drawing that you've done. And this might sound a little weird, but we're moving into another arts form. So just allow a movement to come to you. If this shape moved, how would it move? And you might practice a few different kind of gestures with your hands, with your body. Do it at least three times. You could do this in front of the screen or to the side, whatever you feel comfortable with.
Okay. So I just want to invite you to take a moment to notice any sensations or shifts in your body. Maybe just write a couple words down what that movement felt like in your body. And then take a look at your work, at both pieces of work, and see if any phrases or any words come to mind. And then take a moment to write those down as well. Okay, and when you're ready, you can take your eyes off your work. We're just going to pause for a few moments here. I want to invite you to breathe in deeply from your nose, to hold it for just a moment before exhaling fully through your mouth. And we're going to repeat this a few times, so at your own pace. And really just allowing yourself to fill up your lungs, allowing yourself to fully exhale. And then just bringing your breath back to its normal pace and rhythm, and bringing your eyes back to your work. And if your drawings could say something to you, if there was perhaps a wise message in there for you, what might it say? I'll just take a moment to consider that and then write it down if something comes to you. Take another moment there. So I'm wondering if there are any courageous volunteers who might be willing to discuss what that was like. Any challenges, any insights, you know, just what that experience was like for you.
I could share.
Okay, Whitney, thanks.
You know, I noticed more flow. My mind was quieter. I had a lot less thoughts. They were moving slower and my thoughts could flow better than they usually do. And I think part of that was just slowing down, and part of that was not worrying about the next thing as much.
Mm-hmm. Thank you for sharing that with us. Yeah. Anyone else willing to share a little bit about what that was like for you?
I'm always amazed by how quickly the arts gets to the heart, just, you know, like that.
Yeah. Yep. Nice. Thank you, Rob. Yeah.
Insight there.
I'm wondering if any of you might consider like using this type of intervention for yourself or in your work, or maybe you're already doing it. Yeah, a little thumbs up there. All right.
Okay. All right, well, I think that we will open the floor to questions then, or comments. Mary Beth, nice to see you.
Nice to see you. This has been such a pleasure. I went to school with Cynthia and Melissa, but it's been a while. So I currently work with the severely and persistently mentally ill, and I'm actually in a supervising position. So I have staff who do direct service. And it sounds like there may be some overlap with the population that you're currently working with. I'm also wondering if the folks that we have at our clinic are in some cases more severe. And I guess part of the reason I'm wondering that is that when I try and picture doing this type of activity with some of our folks, I feel anxious. And I think it's because my gut instinct is that they need a lot more containment. Yeah. They have a lot of like basic needs that aren't met. Many of them are homeless. They don't have a device to do this kind of group on Zoom. Mm-hmm. Or they're actively psychotic or any number of things. Mm-hmm. And so I just wonder if in your experience, like how you sort of determine the population that is going to benefit. Maybe I'm just totally wrong and this is all my stuff and people can benefit even if they're really struggling actively with a lot of symptoms. Anything you have to say about that topic?
Sure. Well, I can't see you right now, Cynthia, but I'll start and then I'll pass to you.
Okay, sure.
A couple of things that come to mind is that we're really giving a broad, since I've gone into practicum and postgraduate kind of stuff, broad perspective of what's meant by art, right? Mm-hmm. So can we talk about metaphor? Can we use metaphor to describe current mood? You know, that counts, I would say, as expressive arts therapy. Can I really just attend to the bottoms of my feet on the floor? Right? It's really in the moment accessing what's available to you. But as you know, expressive arts therapy is about just, you know, engaging, it's active. It's how can I do that and make it adapted to that particular patient? So the kinds of interventions that some of them we've described are like, you know, 50-minute kind of more formal sorts of things. But I might, in working individually with the patient, really think about how can I get them more in the moment? You know, what could they be doing? And they're really like making whatever they're paying attention to in the moment a little bit more interesting, or I don't know, a little bit more, I don't know, in the space of play, you know, where they're a little bit using their creativity. I don't know, Cynthia, what would you add?
I think that like without a lot of containment and without a lot of directives, the expressive arts can feel uncontained and could possibly feel scary. I want to validate that. And that is something that you have to bring a lot of thought and intention to when you're working with someone who might be mad, might be psychotic. Mm-hmm. And so, that's really valid. And, you know, when I do have patients in group that are psychotic or sometimes manic, there are a lot of directives. The time frames are really clear. You know, like I'm thinking about watercoloring. I might do a watercoloring group, which I've done so many times and has so much therapeutic value to it. I want to do it a lot. But I would choose very soothing music without words, having it softly in the background. I would make the directive simply, let's apply color to paper. Maybe you're going to decide to move it in one direction. You're going to choose your favorite color and you're just going to work on putting this color on the page And it might even be that simple, but doing that quietly with a group actually has a lot of therapeutic value. And it's just like calming the nervous system, but people mm-hmm. can really, I think that you can use it, and to just be mm-hmm. really clear on what the directives are. And part of it is also just the harvesting. How was that for you? You know, I think it's doable. And we've certainly done it with really acute patients. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
There can be a lot of meaning in one line.
Or storytelling about a time they did something they didn't think they could do. Just kind of, you know, having them describe setting the scene, you know, where were they? What time did it happen in? What was the challenge? I mean, there are lots of ways you can kind of make it safe. And directives mm-hmm. and rules tend to make it safe. I think in graduate school, we had an experience that was a little bit more expansive. And part of our work in the hospital has been how to take the expressive arts and actually make it a little bit less expansive so that it's not so scary for patients that are a little bit less tethered.
Yeah,
that's been grounding. My experience of it. What's that?
So grounding as opposed to, going into mm-hmm. enrolling, getting into a different role.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Melissa and Cynthia, this is really great. For a clinician who's not an expressive arts therapist or clinician, doesn't have, particular training in that, but might have a patient that would be someone who could benefit from it. What thoughts do you have in terms of making a connection or maybe even doing something in their time with the patient that's along those lines that's reasonable?
Yeah, I mean, actually you start this time because I started last time.
Well, I think a really simple place to go, one thing is, if you're not an expressive arts therapist, which you don't have to be one to use this, is to not do any kind of intervention until you've tried it on yourself. So if you've got a plan to do an arts practice, please do it yourself before you ask anyone else to do it. There's a lot of value in that. And then, you might start with an image. You get a deck of cards. There are some really beautiful cards out there. You can collect postcards. You could even buy a deck of like artsy tarot cards and cut the words off and just use the images. And you might ask someone to draw an image. What's coming to mind? What does this mean to you? It's a really lovely way to start working with symbolism and metaphor. And that's a really simple directive. And you could even have them write a little bit about it or do a little drawing in response to it. I think that's a simple starting point. I don't know, Melissa, if you want to say anything about that or.
Sure. I mean, also like just really keeping it simple, all of kind of the things that we have talked about here, but within constraints, like use of metaphor, what's a color that represents how you're doing. I'm also thinking about the way this is framed in acceptance and commitment therapy, where there's this process of like getting in touch with the physical sensations of an emotion and the urge that comes with that, and then where in your body you're really feeling that, and if there was a color and an image that went with that. We're starting really simple, but allowing that patient to kind of give us some feedback about what seems to be working for them. Containing, I'm often thinking about grounding and containing sorts of things and getting people out of their heads. So anything that's kind of bringing them to their senses, mm-hmm. building upon, bring to the sense and build upon.
Can you tell us about your book?
Such pressure. Well, before pandemic and parenting at home, but also still, we're working on a book that's about bringing the arts into expressive arts therapy. Like, how would we teach particular skills of dialectical behavior therapy in an expressive art sort of way? So I don't know what else you would say about that. We don't have a title.
Yeah, we're still working on, just looking at the skills. And sometimes the skills can feel really prescriptive, and finding a way to practice them in an artistic way, to remember them, to make connections between them, that sort of thing. Yeah.
And before your book comes out, if people were interested in EXA, learning more about it, what would your recommendations be?
Well, we have a book list and list of podcasts at the end of this.
I didn't actually show them, but they're available. I don't know if we need to show them now, but there are lists there. There are a few books out there that give some descriptions of how you might run a group and different interventions that you might use. And lots of, I don't know about going to school. I don't know if you want us to describe that, but you know, getting a master's might be.
You could also look at like the International Expressive Arts Therapy Association, which I don't think that we have on that list, but certainly IATA, it's called, IEATA, has a lot of information about how you can become an expressive arts therapist.
Yeah. So I don't know if there aren't any further questions.
I have one more.
Okay, sure.
For patients in the partial hospital intensive outpatient, as they, you know, bring their treatment to a close, what do you find that patients, you know, take away in terms of maybe a continuing practice for themselves? What have you found? I mean, it's probably all over the map in terms of the different types of expressive therapies, but just, and what kind of guidance might you give them for self-practice?
Mm-hmm. If I can start there, Melissa, if that's okay. I have found that patients have really taken to mandalas, to sometimes even just buying coloring books that have beautiful designs and mandalas in them that they'll draw, that they can use for self-soothing and for grounding. I've also found that people come back to gratitude journaling. That seems to be something that people really connect to. Sometimes it's really simple, but just, you know, getting in touch with their bodies a little bit more, stretching and moving. And it's really simple. It translates more into like getting outside and going for a walk. But I think that like when we bring attention to movement in group, you know, that does translate to, wow, this feels good to be in my body. This feels good to move. Maybe I should be walking a little bit more. So things like that. But yeah, I feel like it's, I do hear quite a bit of people feeling really kind of connected to visual arts, coloring, drawing, journaling. That's less language as well. I don't know, Melissa, how you would answer
that. Sure. And also, I mean, people speaking to the power of mindfulness and mm-hmm. that the expressive arts, like I think all of them can really help you to drop in and to cut out of, you know, all of the thinking and really come back to the moment. And so we've talked about the different arts types, but visual art can really help there. Anything that's moving your body too, movement. A lot of people picking up instruments again, you know, coming back to the arts that they already know can be really helpful. I was gonna say something else, but I lost. Oh yeah, just also in the context of groups, I've seen some feedback from the program where the insight-based or like the perspective-changing kinds of things that we've done in group have been helpful, where it's like taking a thought and challenging it in a sort of wacky and creative sort of way. Gifts from future self, accessing wise mind and stuff like that. All right.
Okay. All right.
Well, thank you both so much for this great presentation.
Thank you. Really thank you for coming. I really want to just thank everyone thank you, for coming. Everyone. It was really lovely to reflect on this and to share it.
And one other thing, if anyone has an interest in the slides, are you okay with them being shared? I can send them out.
Yes, sure. Great.
Okay. Well, we'll go ahead and sign off. Thank you everybody for attending today.
Thank you so much.